We poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy and ask you for Christ's sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Beseech you, Almighty God, Heavenly Father, to grant us a true faith, a firm hope in your mercy, and a sincere love to our fellow men, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The Old Testament reading is in Deuteronomy 32, 39 to 40. See now that I myself am he. There is no God besides me. I put to death and I bring to life. I have wounded and I will heal, and no one can deliver out of my hand. I lift my hand to heaven and solemnly swear, as surely as I live forever. The epistle lesson is in Ephesians 3, 13 through 21. I ask you, therefore, not to be discouraged because of my sufferings for you, which are your glory. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through the truth. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and how long and how high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses every knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurable more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that he is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So ends the lessons.
Let us confess together our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
may be seated, and I invite the children to come up again this morning and join me here. Boy, I look at you this morning. And did you're not looking at me? I want to have all of your attention from every one of you, because you know you are special. Did you know that? And that God really cares about you. You know, life starts a really long time before we ever take our first breath here on earth, doesn't it? For 9 months, we are being developed. And from a little egg and a little sperm, and that all comes together, and God begins to form us into people. And it reminds me of what the Bible talks about, a pearl of great price. A pearl of great price. You know how a pearl gets started? You know where do they go mining pearls? You know, where do they come from? Well, pearls come from oysters. Did you know that? From in the ocean. And it doesn't start with the oyster. Do you know what? A little grain of sand. You know how big a grain of sand is? Pretty small, isn't it? I'm not talking about a whole sand. Handful of sand or shovel full, but just one grain. And that gets in that oyster, and the oyster can't kick it out. It can't get rid of it. So what does it do? That oyster starts to coat that grain of sand and coat it and coat it and coat it. And finally, one day it falls in the net of the fishermen, and the fishermen get the oyster up out of the sea. And they open it up, and lo and behold, what's inside? That was in an oyster one time. That's a real pearl. That's a pearl. Now my wife has got a pearl necklace. I'm going to brag here, see, because I really love her. And she's put up with me for 61 years. And I gave her this little pearl, but she's got another one too. Because it's of great value, and it's a way to show us, that it was my way to show her that I care for her, I love her. So when you see a pearl like that, I bet you'd like to have a ring like that, wouldn't you? No. Yeah. Would you like to have a ring? No, you wouldn't. Okay. Would you like to have a ring like that? Yeah. You can't have it. That's Clara's ring. Well, someday you'll get married, and your husband will give you, or one of you guys will get married, and then you'll give it to your wife and say, "I want to give up something of great value." Because you, each one of you, are of great value. You know that in your families, that you are of great value. You're important. But I want you to understand today that God loves you and He cares for you. You are of more value than this pearl, much more value. I don't care how big the pearl is. But that which started with just a little grain of sand has become a pearl of great price. Does God care for you? How do we know? Think about the pearl of great price. Thank you. Dude, I'm going to talk about that today too, so you pay attention, okay? All right. Thank you, guys. appropriately to sing this next hymn. Does Jesus care? And just look at the words of the hymn. It is so good. It's a real, really a confirming, affirming truth there. Does Jesus care? Oh, yes, he cares. All right, let's sing hymn number 577. Gospel according to St. Luke, be reading verses 11 through 17. Should we do stand for the reading of God's word as we read in Jesus' name? And it came about soon afterwards that he went to a city called Nain, and his disciples were going along with him, accompanied by a large multitude. Now as he approached the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and a sizable crowd from the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he felt compassion for her, and he said to her, "Do not weep." And he came up and touched the coffin, and the bearers came to a halt, and he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." And the dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. And fear gripped them all. And they began glorifying God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us, and God has visited his people." I thank you, Lord, for these words. Now I pray that you just lead us and guide us into the truth, for your word is truth. Amen. You may be seated. I don't know if you caught that last stanza of the hymn, the stanza itself. Does Jesus care when I've said goodbye to the dearest on earth to me, and my sad heart aches till it nearly breaks? Is it aught to him? Does he see? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. And when the days are weary and the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. That is what took place that day at the gate to the city of Nain. We have a wonderful, wonderful, encouraging picture of the caring Christ. Prior to these verses, the first 10 verses tell about the healing of the centurion's slave. And now in these verses, we have the raising of a young man from the dead. In the study of this account, one word stood out in the Greek and spoke to me. It's a word that gives us great hope for today. The word appears in verse 16. Episkepsato. I think that's a tongue twister in Greek. What it is really saying is that God has visited us. And what's so significant about that? Well, the crowd who had observed what had happened acknowledged not only that a young man was raised from the dead and a widow was given hope again, but that God had been there and it was a visitation from God. Have you had experiences like that? Something that's happened in your life and you wonder, or maybe at the time it was just an impossible situation, and then it seems like you kind of move through that, and then you look back and you say, God was in the midst of that. It is that which gives us hope and encouragement. Yes, God does care. God does care. Now, God does care in the midst of the hopelessness of death. Luke tells about the encounter of Jesus from the perspective of him approaching the entrance to the city, and that there were followers with him, people who were his disciples. And then he was quite popular at that time, and there were others who came along with him. What's really interesting is what is said and what is not said. The dead person is the only son, and is always so devastating to a parent to lose a child. But this was a widow, someone who'd lost her husband, and now she's lost her son. And that really essentially says that she has lost her future, because who's going to care for her? They didn't have Social Security and didn't have assisted living and all the things that we have today. The children were the guarantee of their care in old age. It's a widow who's lost a son that was at the time the only hope for her future. As a widow losing her only son, she's alone. The devastation of the of the mourning and the emptiness, such a hopeless future. Because without Jesus and what he did in overcoming death, there is nothing but hopelessness. But for the believer, we have the hope for eternity. And I encourage you this morning in that truth, that reality, trust in Jesus. He gives us a future. Yes, this is a broken-hearted mother. Barclay, in his commentary, writes, "In the nature of things, we live in a world of broken hearts." Isn't that so true? And so, the stark reality of her deep pain, walking out of the city, taking her son out to be buried, because he couldn't do that in the city, there was hopelessness, and there was a great crowd who felt for her. But you know what? The depth of pain, I don't care how many people are there, cannot change the circumstance. We can only share in the suffering of the loss of a loved one. I remember there's a situation going on with my son-in-law, and it's a scary thing. I mean, cancer is a scary thing. And I made the statement over the phone, "Well, Mike, we're with you in prayer." He says, "What do you mean you're with me? I'm doing this myself and you're not doing it." You know, he was right. I could only pray for him. He was a long ways away. No matter what, even if I were with him, I couldn't change anything. But God is the difference, makes the difference, you see. And that's what we need to see this morning. In the midst of this finality and hopelessness that's being experienced by this lady and that crowd that went with her, they came to realize that at a time like that, houses, possessions, and all the other things mean so little. All that's been worked for, the plans for the future, when death comes along and snatches all of that away, there's just one huge empty void. And then we see the full account that the Holy Spirit gives to us in the text this morning, because while there is hopelessness in death for the unbeliever, Jesus brings life. Oh, permit me to pause for just a moment to join those who are accompanying the widow going out of the city gate. And I'm sure that the focus for the widow and for those accompanying her is just to be able to get through the day. She and those who are with her are not much aware of what's going on around them. But God had a plan, you see. More than likely, they didn't see Jesus coming. And they didn't even pay a whole lot of attention, because when you go through a time like this, you know, you're saying, "Boy, even this group that's with you, but it's just impossible." Not seeing that there comes Jesus, a man coming down, and a whole group following him, and they meet there at the one place in the city where they had to meet, at the gate as they passed through. One going out, the others coming in. And the widow with the son being carried in a coffin. I've seen those processions. Oh, I tell you, it'll make the hair stand up on the back of your neck. I remember seeing this because in the village above us there in Bolivia, they would come down past above us, because down below was the cemetery. And they would be, you could hear the howling and the lamenting and the weeping as they moved down carrying the loved one who had passed out of this life. And many times I think about, thought back about that, how hopeless that was. These were not believers. And and there was just a tragic emptiness to their lament. But Luke now tells us that there are eight very significant things that made such a difference. Jesus, you see, always is at the right place and at the right time. Jesus knew exactly what was the timing, and God in his plan met that. Those two processions met each other there at the gate to the city of Nain. It was the one place where all had to meet because of the going through the gate. And you know what? It was at that place where Jesus met that procession that made such a difference, because that was the end of the funeral procession. That was the end of the lamenting, and it was replaced with joy, because Jesus makes a difference. You know, that's true throughout the Bible, isn't it? That God has met people at special places. I think of Jacob at the river Jabbok, where he wrestles with God. God met him in a very special place. Or Moses out tending his sheep in Midian, and God meets him out there in that desert plain to do such a miraculous thing as to be brought back to Egypt and to lead the nation Israel out of bondage. Or Isaiah, there in the temple, and God reveals himself. God meets him there in the temple and gives him a vision of the world and of all that's around him, and he sees, as he's never seen before, the great fallenness of mankind in comparison to the holiness of God. God met him in the temple. God met a rebellious Jonah, of all places. What a meeting place, in the belly of a whale. I could think of better places to meet. I think I'd rather meet in the temple, wouldn't you? I think Jonah would agree with you. But God had a plan. And he delivered Jonah, and he sent him on to preach in Nineveh. Jesus that met the woman with all the husbands there at Jacob's well, and she found out in the meeting with Jesus what a difference it made in her life, and so did the city when she went to tell them. Or Saul on the way to Damascus. Wow, what a meeting that was, eh? I'm not going to say what I was going to say, but he had a meeting, and God humbled him. And Jesus is here this morning to meet every one of us here. He has a plan for our lives. He has is the ability to change the whole perspective. Whether it is an awakening to say, oh, this is what God wants, or, oh, so you're God, to come to know Jesus. He knows then also how to meet you. Jesus, secondly, as I mentioned, not only the right place, but the right time, just as the procession arrives. Not a coincidence, it's a divine appointment. Lots of divine appointments we have in our lives, don't we? Never too early, never too late. God does have a plan so that even what appears to be an accident is not. God is still actively seeking to encounter people, individuals, us, even us today. Today, says the Bible, is the day of salvation. Thirdly, Jesus saw and perceived the situation beyond what anyone else was capable of being able to see that day. He saw the widow and her suffering, and he saw her in her sorrow. He saw the son being carried in this basket-like coffin. He saw the crowd in its kindness of support for the widow. And he saw what everyone needed at that time. And I want you to understand this morning that nothing, absolutely nothing, is hidden from God. And Jesus understands everything in our experiences, that nothing is hidden from him. So fourthly, we see that Jesus was moved with compassion. Because he saw and perceived what was going on, he understood the bigger picture. It says that that Jesus was moved in such a way that he was even physically impacted. This splagizomai, this word in Greek that says compassion, really means that we are deeply, even like so the viscera is affected physically. You've had that, haven't you? We call it a gut feeling, kind of a gross term, but you know, reacting to that. You see an accident and you're your blood pressure goes up, or you see something that happens, you're moved deeply. Jesus was deeply moved that day. But we see in the Gospels that he was many times deeply moved. We do have, folks, a compassionate God. And we see that in these verses, a compassionate God. Fifthly, he spoke out, being deeply moved. He speaks directly to the widow. And, you know, if you or I had said, "Oh, lady, don't cry," what do you think? What hypocrisy, right? But when God says it, it's different. And it's in the imperative mood here. It says, Jesus says, "Stop your weeping. Stop your lamenting. Stop your..." And the word that is in the original means that there was loud, audible crying. Like I said, I can relate to that sad, desperate lament, crying out. I hope I can get through this one. It was Patricio Manmani's little boy. We were out in the mountains of Bolivia. Yeah, we did have a little clinic there, and Margie Erickson was so good at that. She was sort of self-trained. And Henrik, he was an engineer, but he patched up a lot of heads and put a lot of stitches on and did a lot of things. He was also raised on a farm, so he knew how to do some of these things, because you do, as farmers, learn how to do that, don't you? But that morning, we couldn't do anything. The little boy, Patricio's little boy, got into one of these little, what I forget what they're called, but they were a bean. And they're like instant death. What happens is that the children, you know, will play with them like marbles. They're that kind of, that size. And they will get them in their mouth, and then they will swallow them. And what happens is that the bean gets lodged in the larynx and then begins to swell and shuts off the larynx. And that's what happened to the little boy. I tell you, the hurt is so deep. And poor Henrik, I felt so bad for him afterwards. He says, "I couldn't do anything to help him." Then he said, "You know, if I'd been thinking faster, I maybe could have done a tracheotomy. I could have, you know, because he would have attempted it. I mean, there's no one else to do it." I don't know if it would have saved his life. It was above or below that we're lodged. I don't know. But the sad, that little boy was gone just a matter of minutes. For me to say to Patricio, "Don't cry, brother," I didn't do that. But Jesus can do that. Because of what not only he says, but what he does. Jesus went over to that coffin and touched it. Now, mind you, the Jewish thinking, anyone who is around a dead person or touches anything like that is considered immediately unclean. So in the eyes of all the people that day, they saw, Jesus, you did something. Oh, very, very bad. You touched that coffin. But oh boy, in the eyes of the mother, that was not a bad thing. Because you see, Jesus wasn't polluted. He was overcoming death. He is the one and the only one that could call from the grave, as he did Lazarus, and call to life. So he goes over to that bier, and he does get involved physically in the life of that young boy, the death of that young boy. Hendrickson says it so well, the one who holds the keys of death and Hades, the one who is able to eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners without becoming contaminated would not suffer pollution either by touching the frame. On the contrary, instead of becoming defiled, he was now in the process of conquering death and defilement. He is the overcomer. And so Jesus speaks life to a dead son. Young man, can you just imagine that? Young man, I say to you, arise. I think there were some people that jumped back right at that moment, because that dead son sits up in that coffin. Can you just, I mean, I think that's delightful. It's delightful because there's life there. And then Jesus takes the boy and he gives him back to his mother. I think that young man's life, I'm just kind of dreaming about it and wondering, but I think that young man's life was different from there on, and that widow's life was different from there on. They really believed. They really believed. Even as the crowd said, God has visited us, because you see, God really does care. That's one thing that, folks, we can take encouragement. Edith Schaeffer and Francis Schaeffer, well-known theologians in a sense, writers, Christian writers, some years ago wrote about this. Someday Jesus will speak the word, and all those who have taken him as their Savior and who have died and will be raised from the dead as easily as this man who we have just read about. Jesus will speak the word on that wonderful day, arise. And the bodies of all the believers, no matter how long ago they lived, will come out of their graves, some from India, some from China, some from South America, some from Africa, some from Australia, some from England, some from all the European countries, some from America, and some even from the depths of the sea, wherever in the world people have died, believing that they've been born in God's family. When the word is spoken for the resurrection from the dead, they will arise. We are a people with a hope. God will raise us up, even as he will raise up those of our loved ones who have trusted in Christ, and those if God gives us another day. That's our hope, because God cares about us. God has a good plan for our lives. But more than anything else, we can see here this morning that Jesus was there. Jesus was there. Even as he promised us before he left this world and ascended into heaven, he says, lo, what? I am with you always. Always. Today is always. He's here right now. Let him encourage, confirm, strengthen you in that truth. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the resurrection hope that we see in these verses, and the present day hope that you care and you are with us. This is an eternal commitment you've made. Thank you for that this morning, Jesus. Thank you for the hope that's in you. Amen. Let's continue by turning to hymn number 180. My God, how wonderful thou art. 180.
Thank you.
give thanks, Lord, and place these gifts upon the altar. We just do this in the high and holy name of Jesus. Amen. And Father, as we continue to pray this morning, coming to you with the various petitions that are before us, thanking you, Lord, for your hand of healing and your hand of help. Thanking you that that Eunice is with us this morning, and praying also a word of thanks that Michael is now on the mend as well. We give you thanks and praise for that. We continue to lift up to you the needs of those who are with special physical struggles. We pray for Deb DeCoster and for Margaret Van Hoven. We pray too for Pam and Russell, for Maggie. Thank you, Lord, that Norm is doing so much better. Continue to have your hand upon him. For James and Matt, for Viola, and we pray too, Lord Jesus, for Anna, for Ariel. We pray too, Lord, for continued healing. We know Holly is going through a lot of pain. Would you just give her strength for that? For Eric Nels, Lord, help him through these treatments. Give him strength and patience. May there be great success with this treatment. We pray too for Eunice Reiners and for Tim Schomburg, for Lloyd Ulich. We just thank you that we can lift them up by name as well this morning. And we pray, Lord Jesus, for the church council. You continue to lead and guide them. We thank you for their willingness to serve, and thank you for blessing their service. Pray for the call committee in this process. Lord, we continue to look to you. We know that, Lord, that you are going ahead of us, and we just need to see to follow in the right way. Pray for Dee and Lynn and Emily and Keith and Doug. We just thank you for their willingness to serve. And for the little ones, Lord, in the cradle, Lord, little Isabel and Ava and Luke and Anna and Ellie. For Brooklyn and Harrison and Isabel. For Emmeline, for Jackson and Jameson. We pray too for Charlotte and Vivian, little Vivian. We pray for her and Alex. Thank you that we can lift these little children up in your name. We pray, Lord Jesus, also for our country and our nation, and in these days of politics, that we would just have a sense to see where your hand is in all of this. We pray for our president and Congress, for the governor and state and legislature, for the local leadership in the various communities that we are represented. Lord, we pray for those who serve us. And we also pray, Lord Jesus, for our AFLC and the leadership there. We lift up to you, Lord, this morning, the work in Naknek, Alaska, and as things are sort of buttoning down now for the winter months, we pray that you'd be with the Swansons and the Crowells and the Lees, Steinbergs, as they continue to labor there in that particular place of calling. We pray for the Steinbergs as they are joining them with that, and for KAK and the radio station, that you would just anoint that. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all these hearing of all these petitions, and we want to continue to just pray that prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Bow your hearts to the Lord and receive his benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In closing, let's turn to hymn number 506, Living for Jesus, a Life That is True.